Hi everyone, welcome to Desire Project Pro expert interviews. We have with us today Joy Mustafi. Joy has been a data scientist for almost 14 years right now. And he's been a data scientist in the true sense of the word scientist, because he's also worked in research as well as a practitioner. Initially with IBM as a senior data scientist, and then with Microsoft as a principal applied scientist, and then more recently with Salesforce as a principal researcher in the Salesforce AI team. And apart from this, Joy has also somehow found time to start and run this elite data science club, research club called Must Research. So Joy, thank you so much for taking time.
Thank you, Vin.
Okay. Joy, you know, for the viewers, we would love to start off by understanding, what is Must Research? Why did you start it? What happens in it?
Yeah, so Must Research is meant to promote the excellence of this, the competence of the field of data science and artificial intelligence and machine learning. So even when I was a student, right, I thought about like, can we start something like on the emerging technologies or advanced technologies and all. And then when I had my first job, I just had like meetings with my few of my colleagues and friends, and thought like, okay, let's form a club, or, you know, I mean, a cluster of people where we can actually spend our weekend or something like our free time to contribute with respect to technology for the benefit of the nation. So that was the Uber goal. Okay. And then, and even when I started, like that time, the data science phrase was not there. Data scientist position was also not there.
Right.
Definitely artificial intelligence is a very old term, machine learning and all. And we started with like all these emerging technologies. And then now we have more than 500 members or volunteers, right, across India, who are all contributing with respect to the technology, the advanced technology, for the benefit of the society or the mankind.
Interesting. So do you collectively decide what problems to work on? How do you do that? Or do you decide that?
Yeah. So as I mentioned, right, it could be like very much close to the society. So we focus on few areas, like we call it like hearts. So healthcare, H, then education, then agriculture, A, retail, R, transportation, T, and city, S. So hearts. So this is like HEARTS. So these are the areas where we are focusing, the like the domains. At the same time, horizontally, we cut across with respect to the technology, with natural language processing, computer vision, speech technology, to some extent IoT and robotics as well. We call it like embedded intelligence, where we try to, you know, I mean, embed the algorithm itself in the edge, you know, hardware side as well. So these are like, and then we already collaborated with multiple government, including government of India, government of Telangana, government of West Bengal. We started working, you know, with multiple academia as well, like IIIT Hyderabad, IIT Kharagpur, ISB Hyderabad, and so on.
Very interesting. Great. So, you know, to a point you just mentioned earlier, which is when you started off, there was really nothing defined called data science yet. It was analytics broadly, right? What has changed from then to now when it is suddenly cool? It's very much in demand. What has changed in the role?
Yeah, the thing is, like when I started my journey, even back almost close to 18, 19 years back, right? I mean, early 2000. And that time, only few academic organizations, they focused on the research. So when I was a researcher at Indian Statistical Institute, Kolkata, I started my first program that was on neural network, right? So, and I wrote the entire piece of code by myself, and it was C programming language, right? So that time, I mean, yeah, definitely the academicians, they know about this, right? A lot of other research institutes, like all the IITs, IISc, IIT, so they started this research. But in the corporate world, it was not so famous because corporate always wants like a deterministic based approach, right? I don't want to take risk. Like, okay, it's a probabilistic approach versus a deterministic, or a typical IT software deliverables, those kind of things are there. I mean, early 2000, even some of my friends and colleagues, they said like, why you are wasting time on AI? It is dead. Learn Java, learn, you know, SQL, you'll get a job. But I don't know like whether AI will actually help you to get a job. So that was a scenario. Now, analytics was there. I mean, the term analytics came But that was like mostly descriptive analytics or business intelligence kind of thing. Even the predictive analytics came later. And from there, once we started like this, the change happened, right? Because of the availability of resources, right? Mm. As I mentioned, like I was a researcher at ISI, and that time, even my desktop had a 8 MB of RAM. Mm-hmm. 8 MB. Okay, now I have 32 GB of RAM in my laptop.
Right.
So huge change happened. So in that 8 MB of RAM, my program used to run for 48 hours, a neural network, like all the iterations and everything. So if, even if I changed something like a piece of code, and then I had to wait for 2 days to check the result, and then again, some changes required. So now the same program can be run in within 5-10 minutes and using Python. So a lot of things got changed because of the hardware availability, data availability, like a lot of different forums are there where we can get like public data and all. And this open source libraries, which were not there at that time. We had like only C, C++ or Java, that kind of languages there. And few packages like MATLAB, but those are like all licensed product. There is no free open source version of these kind of packaged libraries, right? So these are the changes happened in this. And then definitely the corporate world also got interested. I still remember when I was working with IBM and I was a like analytics consultant that time. And then they launched IBM Watson. And that was the first like corporate, like kind of a product. I mean, I found like, which is based on AI. It is actually based on natural language processing and information retrieval. And then I got interested and I moved to IBM Watson and started contributing like how to fill, how to bridge the gap between what customer wants and what we had that time. So I started like patenting, like starting with ideation to implementation. And then, you know, I mean, how we can actually protect the intellectual property for the organization. So right now I have around 65 patents and all related to this data science and AI.
Wow, wow. So the biggest transformation in your experience has been this scale-up of processing power and hardware and libraries and interfaces and APIs available.
And data. Availability of data. Because I collected primary data. I requested all of my friends and colleagues, like, please write. I was working on handwritten recognition. So I actually gave like A4 sheet and then requested them, like, please write here and give it me. Give it back to me.
Wow.
Because there was no such kind of open data set or something like that.
Right, right. Okay. And coming in today's environment, if a data science job aspirant is looking to break in, obviously they'll do many things. What is that single biggest thing you think they should focus on where they'll get the maximum leverage?
So it's a kind of, so any data scientist should have like multiple things or multiple hats, right? First of all, like the researcher. So, I mean, the word scientist, right? It's very heavy, right? So we have to prove ourselves with respect to the innovations. I mean, innovation, these things. So that comes with patent papers and all. So I would first recommend like they should do research, think out of the box. That is the number one. Number two is like the engineering side as well, right? So we have to think about like, even if I'm a researcher, I should not be a theoretical researcher only. So I should like code, I can write like whatever I'm thinking mathematically or statistically, all those algorithms should be written in code, whatever the language is. Even if it is C, C++, Java, Python, R, programming language is not like a constraint here, but any programming language, but I can translate my mathematical logic into computational. Solution, right? So that is very important. That's the second part. Third is scholar, right? Everyone should always think like, I'm still a student. I'm a scholar. Irrespective of the age, experience level, everything. Because, I mean, if we stop learning, then we cannot grow. Because it's a, I mean, every week, you can see like there are a lot of new algorithms are coming up. I mean, probably last year end, we had this GPT-3, which is like one of the interesting algo, right? I mean, but the thing is like, if we don't know what is GPT-3 or what is even GPT, right? And say like, no, I'm a data scientist, but I'm coming from like classical machine learning background, and I don't want to learn, then actually I'm losing a lot of opportunities. So scholar is very important. Then it's teacher, which is not mandatory, but I still love to like, suggest others, like, try to teach others, right?
Yeah.
So a lot of things get clear. So I still love teaching. I am a visiting faculty at IIT Kharagpur and ISB Hyderabad right now. And I taught almost like across India, I mean, as a visiting faculty in multiple academia, mostly tier one organizations, at the same time other colleges as well. But that helped me a lot to clear a lot of doubts. And while I studied those as a student and also implemented those as a practitioner in corporate world, but while actually I'm teaching those the same thing, a lot of new things come up. I mean, a lot of queries from the students and interacting with them, right? So it's again another learning opportunity while teaching. So I really love this REST, REST. Like researcher, engineer, scholar, and teacher.
That's
so
a very nice framework.
All things should a data scientist should have.
And while they do this, and obviously most of them go to Google, are there specific online resources that you have relied on or you suggest people should rely on that are super helpful?
It's an ocean, right? I mean, Bini, there is, I don't have like a particular list of that.
Yeah.
I mean, but when I started my journey, right, I went through Dan Jurovsky's video on, like, I first read the book, right, on NLP, natural language processing.
Yeah.
But the book, Dan Jurovsky's NLP, was like a classical-based approach. But I am really, what I mentioned, like the scholar, right? So even he is a so senior professor and a scientist. He also upgraded himself. And his lectures now, if you see the YouTube video channel, he is also using the latest technologies, the latest algorithms, even the deep learning based approaches, right? Even if I go through the Andrew Ng's ML open videos, right,
On YouTube,
those are all like being continuously updated with the latest technologies.
Right.
So there are like a lot of such materials there. I mean, but at the same time, we still need teachers, right? I mean, it's good to have like self-learning mode and all, but there are multiple things. I mean, we still go to school. We still go to college. We don't just go to the bookstore and borrow the books, or, you know, we don't go to the only the library, right? We still need like the supervisor, teacher who can handhold us.
Yeah.
So that's very important. And that is the reason like we started Mass Research Academy. So which is, again, it's a nonprofit organization. At the same time, we are trying to serve the purpose of like a very advanced applied research program with a very like affordable fee structure. Again, supported by multiple governments and all.
Very nice.
I mean, why? Because again, I mean, we still need that kind of a supervision from who can help us, right?
Yeah.
I mean, who can guide continuously and monitor what we are doing.
And especially a point about, you know, that one of the best ways to learn is to actually teach. I think that's a fantastic way for people to get into this and learn in more depth. You mentioned GPT-3 right now. So I'm curious, what is so fundamentally different about GPT-3, other than obviously the humongous data set on which it has been trained? Why is it getting so much attention?
Yeah, so definitely it's the latest one, right? And like it's the full form is like generative pre-trained transformer. So it's kind of a transformer-based learning, right? And it is, released by OpenAI, and then a lot of other implementation happened.
Right.
The concept here, right? I mean, when I started my journey, right? I mean, with a classical-based machine learning kind of thing, right? Those are like all feature engineering-based. So feature engineering means, like, as a human being, if I identify, like, these are the features of a dog and a cat, and then I am defining those features with respect to the supports in image processing, right? So, or if it is a digit recognition, suppose like 0 to 9. Now, if I am, I know like this, how the 0 looks or how the 8 looks, right? And all these features, I am defining them with respect to my knowledge or with respect to my domain knowledge. It can be like anything. It can be on healthcare domain. It can be on manufacturing, telco and something, right? But I am using my human intelligence and knowledge or experience to identify those features. And once I determine the feature, then I used to feed that in the whatever the algorithm or classification, or it can be for any detection or recognition project, right? But in this kind of a transformation or transformer based learning, right? So the entire thing has changed, right? It's kind of a autoregressive. And then if we use it for language model, right? And this deep learning based model, so where these things are all automated. So even the network, so it's so deep and all, and it will actually learn from its own. So that's interesting. And then this generation part, right? I mean, it's not about only understanding, because if I consider like natural language processing, it has natural language understanding and natural language generation. So how like we can actually develop which is more human like language generation. So that helps, I mean, with this GPT kind of technologies, I mean, which is generative pre-trained transformer, right? So that helps a lot. So, and why it is popular, but yeah, I mean, definitely it's new.
Right. Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think like with respect to the corresponding appropriate data set and processor, right? So everything, like everything has a pros and cons. So,
okay.
So all the latest algorithms are process hungry, data hungry. So we have to put like those adequate amount of data, use that kind of a GPU or TPU, right? So those are the constraints again.
Sure.
At the same time, the algorithms are powerful.
Okay. Okay. So one of the things, for example, we do at Project Pro Joy is that we help basically data scientists get their work done faster by giving these reusable templates. I'm just curious, from your experience, are there some tactics, hacks that you can share to be more efficient at your projects, to get your projects done faster that people can use?
You mean to say like to deliver a project in a faster way?
Yeah.
Okay. So I prefer always a spiral model. So I always start like an end-to-end hello world. So you build that because the data science project is not a separate thing, or we are not like sitting in Mars and then the entire the rest of the thing is different, right? So we have to always think about like how we can integrate that with the proper product pipeline, how we can handshake with the engineering team, architecture team, even user interface design team, right? So those things are all clubbed together. We cannot say like, oh, we are focusing only on the accuracy. So what I prefer, right? I mean, always let's try to have like a basic algorithm, the simplest algo, mm-hmm. and run it, but it should run end to end. Then you improve the algorithm, change the algo, right? And make it like more accurate, but then without hampering the entire pipeline, without breaking that. So that helps me to, you know, I mean, conclude like, okay, we are at this stage, rather than like spending a lot of time on deep research and then the production team, right? I mean, they are thinking like, hey, what these data scientists are doing? I mean, they're not delivering, right? So that's the thing. So start with the simplest algo. Don't jump into GPT, even a rule-based, and then make like classical machine learning-based, then like deep learning-based, then go with this transformer-based and so on, right? So that's my nature of work.
That's fantastic. Basically, ship it first and then keep iterating. Okay, super. Joy, that's all we really had for today. Thank you so much for taking time.
Most welcome.
Yeah, really appreciate it.
Thanks, Billy. Thanks for having me.
Bye-bye.